Welcome to today's meeting of Democrats of Greater Tucson. We're absolutely delighted that you're here. My name is Larry Bodine and I'm the president. And today we have a very important topic to discuss. And that is the coming eviction crisis, which is going to come to Tucson on April 1st. Some estimates are that 30,000 outstanding eviction orders will be carried out when the federal eviction moratorium expires that day. And the Pima County supervisors are meeting tomorrow on whether to appropriate $2 million so that tenants can afford attorneys. And today for an on-the-ground report about the situation, our speaker today is Pima County Constable Kristen Randall. Kristen, give us a wave. How are you today?
Good.
Excellent. We're delighted you're here.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
But first, let's have some announcements. Let me turn first to Kathy Ramage White to please tell us about membership.
Thank you, Larry. I appreciate the introduction. Everybody, welcome. You know, do you remember when you were a kid, there was a romper room show where the lady would start out looking in like a giant magnifying glass and she would say, I see Larry. Oh, and there's Susie. Oh, do you remember seeing that at all as a kid, or am I the only one? But that's what being on Zoom reminds me of, because when I put it in the gallery view, I get to see everybody and I want to say, oh, there we are. There's Marion. Oh, I see Barbara. But that's just being silly. I think I'm getting COVID silliness, folks, but I'm feeling well, and I sure hope all of you are feeling well. And if you haven't renewed your DGT membership yet, please do so. It's easy to do, and it only costs you $20. If you have renewed, thank you very much for your renewal. And if you haven't yet, go ahead and renew during the meeting. You can do that and still be a good, attentive audience. Thank you, Larry. Right back to you.
All right. Thank you, Kathy. Now let's turn to Sandy Binion to tell us a little bit about our upcoming meetings.
Okay. Well, first, thank you, Kristen, for scheduling for today for us and coming to speak to us today. Next week, we're going to have Billy Kovac, who is the outreach director for Ann Kirkpatrick, to tell us a little bit about what Ann is doing these days. The following week, we're going to have Miranda Schubert, who is a candidate for City Council Ward 6. And the following week, we're going to have Catalina Hall, who's the chairperson of LD 11. So I hope you can all join us and hear some of our interesting and exciting speakers coming up.
All right, thanks very much, Sandy. It's now my pleasure to introduce Kristen Randall. She is a Democrat who was reelected in the November elections as one of 10 separately elected Pima County constables. And interestingly, she is one of the rebel constables who are actually helping families to keep their homes. And with her own past as a single mom facing homelessness, improving the eviction process is less of a job and more of a mission for Kristen. Kristen is helping tenants by hand delivering documents called minute entries, so people have a little more time to decide what to do next. The constables also provide information about shelters and services, as well as a new county grant that could help residents to avoid an eviction. And with that, Kristen, the floor is yours.
Thank you, and thank you everybody for having me. We'll get to the rebel constable moniker in a little bit of a minute. And I do want to point out that Constable Bernal is on the call today. And I'll talk about a little bit about what we're doing. So my name is Kristen Randall. I am originally from New York. I have two kids, a 19-year-old and a 5-year-old. So they keep me kind of busy. I was a hydrologist before I was a constable. So I did work with the Geological Survey, and I was really interested in the little pre-meeting conversation that everybody was having about water. I might not be a hydrologist anymore, but you know, it's still in my heart. So that's who I am. How did I come to go from hydrology to being a constable is really interesting. I was involved in activism. I was very interested in politics, but I absolutely didn't want to be a politician. But at a certain point, Mary Dorgan had resigned, and there was a position open. And a very dear friend of mine had called me up and recommended that I put my name in for it. And he mentioned there's a different way to do the job. And he knew me really well. He knew how to hook me in. So that's how that happened. I at one point had lunch with Constable Bernal, and Constable Bernal told me there's a different way to do the job. And he laid it out. He said, there's the old way of doing it, where it's very law enforcement. You go out, you serve these papers. But he's like, that's not the way I do it. But Constable Bernal kind of hooked me there too. So, I did get the appointment, and, then it was, basically Constable Bernal and I, at that point being, I guess newbie rebel constables, although I would argue that Bennett has always been a rebel. So what we did is we were looking at some of the ways that, so I see statute. Let me back up. There might be people who don't know what a constable does, or you're not really clear. You do elect your constable. There's 4-year terms. We have separate precincts. They're called justice precincts. And you vote for your JP, your judge, and then you also vote for your constable. A constable enforces basically the judgments from the justice court. We serve that paperwork and we enforce them. So that would be evictions, primarily in Midtown Tucson, which is my area. But also we do orders of protection. We do civil summons, we do subpoenas, and then there's some other stuff in there that we don't do often, livestock liens and some kind of oddball, Old West sort of things. So that's what your constable does. But obviously in Midtown Tucson and in Bennett's area of the 05 zip code, evictions are the biggest part of our job. And so statute guides, basically requires that we do certain things in a certain timeline. But if you think of statute as sort of a legal framework for the way things need to be done, within that structure, there's a lot of room for us to do things in a better way. So one thing that we did is we started researching how do other Western states do evictions. And one thing that I turned up was that there's an extra step in many states, California, Utah, Nevada, Colorado. These Western states have an extra step in there where you go through the court process of eviction. And then prior to the eviction, the constable or the sheriff, they go out and they post a notice. It's a notice to vacate. It's basically a last warning before the eviction. So that families will have time to figure things out. Arizona doesn't have that step in there. What we have is you go from the judgment, and then 6 days later, the writ is issued, the eviction order. And then the way it used to be done is the constable would get that paperwork. They would call up the landlord. They would schedule the eviction. And then they would go out, knock on the door, and tell the tenant they have 10 minutes to grab a few things and leave and be locked out. Now, on paper, maybe this sounds okay-ish. The problem is that there's only 2 points in this process where a tenant is given notification of whatever's happening with the eviction. One is the 5-day notice from the landlord, And then they do, a few days later, they'll get a notice from the court saying that they have a hearing coming up. And studies have shown that only 10% of tenants show up for their hearing. So that means 90% of these families aren't exactly sure what the judgment was, or aren't exactly sure what the timeline is, or what to expect during an eviction. So when the constable would show up and do that cold call, you had people with children, folks who were in wheelchairs, disabled, elderly, all of these people who were not prepared. So Bennett and I started to get these judgments from the court prior to the eviction. And we went out and we delivered them to these families to let them know, this is what happened in court. This is what you can expect. And then we started asking the questions, what do you need? What is your plan? And that's where we really started to pull in resources and changing what was happening in our office. Sometimes somebody's Social Security payments had stopped and we were able to talk to the congressional offices to get those started again. Sometimes they just needed a little bit of a rental assistance, and we were able to use county and nonprofit resources to pay off the debt and to let them stay in their home. And sometimes it was just simply coming up with a plan for folks and getting them the resources they need in order to get to a shelter. When Constable Ferguson was with our office, he was our third rebel constable. Obviously we're grappling with these really difficult issues. The pandemic, and I'll address the pandemic a little bit more later on, but we have these confluence of issues, and the pandemic made things worse. So pre-pandemic, we were already dealing with reduced resources for the seriously mentally ill. And that is, I mean, that's a whole other hour-long conversation about housing the mentally ill. The court process is very quick and it's not very accessible to families. Sharply rising rent. I'm sure everybody's familiar enough with what's been in the news with the amount that Tucson's rent has increased. Tucson and Phoenix are in the top 20 for rising rents, and Tucson's rent has actually been rising faster than even Phoenix. And then we have a reduced inventory of apartments that'll accept Section 8 or are considered affordable. As the market was shifting, some of the affordable properties were pulling out of that market and tapping into the more general rental market. And some of these market pressures were because of vacancy rates. So you can think of vacancy rate, it's a percentage, and it's the amount of available and open apartment units per 100. So when I first started, that vacancy rate was at around 6.5%. And I remember reading a report from economists saying once it reached 5%, which would be five available units per 100 units, then we're starting to talk about a really tight market, which is great for the property manager and not so great for the tenant. We are now at 3.6% vacancy. So we are seeing everything that kind of that supply demand curve is thrown out of whack, and prices are skyrocketing and inventory is very low. So what did we start doing? We did that minute entry program. We also worked with the city of Tucson to have them set aside 30 Section 8 vouchers for the constable's office, so we could make direct referrals for people who had very specific and high vulnerability right into the Section 8 program. So we were able to get pregnant moms and disabled folks into the Section 8 program with that. And then we also hired a caseworker in our office. As far as I know, there's no other constable's office that has been hiring social workers, and she's been amazing. a lot of the work that Bennett and I were doing ourselves, having a social worker in our office, she could do it better. She's trained for that. She knows the lay of the land. And her name is Naharin Jabro. She's been to a million DGT meetings before. She used to work for Supervisor Elise's office, and she's been amazing. So now we can talk about the pandemic a little bit. And after I address that kind of confluence, I'll have a graph for you all to see. So it is a little bit of a perfect storm. Low wage earners were hit the hardest. Keith Bentley is an economist with the U of A. He's been doing these economic models for us so that we can, he's been modeling for homelessness, for the recession in the local area, and for what we can expect with evictions. And the numbers aren't good. So for instance, that 40, Patty McElore in the Sunday article talked about evictions, and she said that there are around 4,500 outstanding eviction orders. Those are evictions that with just a little bit of work, they've already gone through the court process, could theoretically, we could go out and do the evictions immediately once the moratoria expire. But there's that number of evictions that we don't have a number for, where the landlords did not go to court because they knew that it would be difficult to get them done and they were going to wait anyway. This number has been modeled to be upwards of 30,000 families potentially in Pima County. So that's a little terrifying. We've already kind of addressed the vacancy rate. So that vacancy rate is actually getting worse. And I remember prior to the pandemic, some folks thought, well, you know, they're not going to be able to rent to anybody. So why, why evict them? But that's just not the case. And with the inventory so low, rents are skyrocketing. So what that means is that people can't find housing. So they're being evicted. It might be on hold because of the moratorium, but they have nowhere to go. And we've been working with folks to try to get them into housing using our resources, and we're not having a lot of success. And Naharin, I know that she's been writing a report and at many meetings, and that's been one of her challenges too. There's also been the technological issues. So now, because court is mostly through Zoom, we have folks who it might have expanded access to some people, but there's also some folks who are just not able to access court in that way. They really don't understand the process. They don't have a smartphone. They don't have internet. They might not feel comfortable going to the library. So all of the pressures that kind of kept people out of court before, I think they've been compounded. Now, that's not across the board. For some people, those with children or without transportation, having online court helped them. So it's complicated. And then, big picture, what are we looking at with evictions and the pandemic? I would say it's kind of a disaster. The court has been really slow to be able to respond to these different challenges. We're looking at families being very affected by this. And when moratoria expire, if we were unable to get rental assistance out, then those families are going to be potentially immediately evicted. This graph right here is eviction hearings from January 2020 through last month, through February. Typically, January and February are the highest months per year for eviction. We've theorized it's because of people overspending over the holiday, but that's just something that people have said at the office. And then it would always kind of come down around March, April, May as people got their tax rebate, but not this far. So what you see happening in April here is the very first, when the pandemic really started to affect the court, and to the first, I think the governor's executive order came out March 26th of last year. So you're seeing that there weren't a lot of evictions filed. But every month since, and we don't have to get stuck on any one month or any one number, but if you look at the trend, we're trending back up. So except for January and February of each year, when we have that higher number, we're usually around about 800, anywhere from 700 to 900 evictions per month. So you can see in February, we're about at 600. We're getting really close to that pre-pandemic number. And technically, we are still under the moratorium. Once the moratorium is gone, we do have those models for, we think it's going to be, I think Representative Engel called it, Senator Engel, sorry. She called it a eviction tsunami, and I don't disagree. I've talked about the problem. What are we doing? So Bennett and I are taking writs, and when they come in, and we are visiting tenants prior to doing the eviction, kind of like what we did before. It's a little bit different mechanism, but that's details. So we're going out, we're talking to the family, and we're saying, hey, are you seeking CDC protection? Did you fill out your letter and give it to your landlord? And what do you need? What kind of resources do you need? Can we sign you up for the county and city eviction prevention program? One of the things that we've been working with the city and the county on is, and they did this last funding cycle. So they've gotten $31 million in for rental assistance that was passed by the federal government back in December for that stimulus. That money is just now hitting the streets. I think actually on Tuesday is when it went live. So the city and the county peeled off a certain amount of that money into a separate little account and assigned separate staff to work directly with the constables, so that there is a list of about 4,000 people waiting in line for those funds. But if we go to somebody's home and they are actively being evicted, we can work out a deal between them and their landlord. We can personally help them with their paperwork, and we can sort of cut the line a little bit and use our own little fund to be able to get that rental assistance out. So that's been really helpful. It was really helpful last funding cycle. I'm sure it'll be helpful this time. We're also going to be setting up workshops. So we're going out to some of these affordable housing apartment complexes and just doing a workshop to help people with their application and make sure we can get those in and make sure they're completed. Another thing that we've been really busy is working with the community and workforce development with the county. We have weekly meetings for everybody to share information and to start addressing issues before they become really bad ones. And something that came out is, what is our plan B? After moratoria expire, what do we do? Because we didn't want to be caught flat-footed. And so those conversations led to conversations with Supervisor Hines, who has been incredibly involved in this process. And as Larry brought up, he's been passing different motions, but he's got two big ones coming up tomorrow at the Board of Supervisors meeting. Larry mentioned the one about the representation. So his motion is for $2 million for the county to contract with STALA or Step Up to Justice to provide representation to tenants. I mean, that's a whole other conversation there too. And then the other motion is for $5 to $10 million to provide hotel vouchers for families who have been evicted and for whatever reason they couldn't stay in their home. Also in that motion is a few folks from community and workforce development who would temporarily work with the constable's office to provide in the field assistance to families who are going through eviction. And that could be, you know, bring them a rental assistance application or arrange for transportation to a shelter or to the hotel, or just provide casework. When we're talking about these issues, we need more casework. And you know, that's something that Joe Bennett and I tried to do ourselves, and we're still doing it. And then we hired Naharin. And at this point, I feel like with what we're facing, you could almost never have enough casework. So that's basically what we're doing. In the future, I think, you know, that sort of fights the fires. I think we could do better in the future to address these issues. So we need to figure out ways to reduce that vacancy rate. And I think those are high level conversations with the city, with the county, with the assessor's office. She has some ideas, and with our partners in housing. We need to invest in housing, and we need to increase the affordable housing inventory, which at this point it's decreasing. So we're going in the wrong direction. One of the things I'm really interested in, whenever I talk about housing and I have people go, oh, tiny homes are the answer. And I've always been like, I don't know. There's too many problems with them. But there's a really great article by about LA, and they've been doing these tiny home communities for the homeless, and the really interesting thing is that article addressed how they overcame NIMBYism, what the costs were, what the difficulties were, and how they made it happen. The interesting thing is that they, instead of these little developments taking months and years to develop, they took weeks. They were able to put 39 families in on a 1 acre odd sized plot in LA for a fairly reasonable cost. I think the structures cost something like $7,500. So that's something we could look at to address homelessness issues. But also, we could also look at doing the same thing, maybe larger units with individual kitchenettes and bathroom facilities for not just for homeless, but for more permanent occupancy. My last little bit of advice is pay attention to your JP and your constable. It matters who you vote for. I wouldn't have been able to name my constable a few years ago. Did I vote for them? Probably. You know, I probably just checked the box, and I don't think they were ever challenged. So, you know, I probably really didn't pay attention to it. But who your constable is matters. Statute does dictate what we have to do, but who you vote for, what their values are, that tells you what more can they do. How more can we serve the community? And like I said, there's the old way of doing it, which is where you just go out, you knock on the door, and you tell them you've got 10 minutes to leave, or you can have the way that we do it. And I think we all share similar values here. So pay attention to those races. Consider running for constable if you're interested in it. And, you know, give us a run for our money. Let's take it over. And pay attention to your judges too, because they also matter. I hope that I've brought information and perspective to everybody, and I would love to answer some of your questions.
Kristen, thank you very much. The work you're doing is really inspiring and important, and I commend you for everything that you do. Let's go to some questions. Let's start with Don Womack. Please go ahead and ask your question.
Hey, Don. Well, Kristen, I'm so impressed with what you're doing. It's just awesome, and it's just unbelievable. The work you do, going to their houses to help them, I mean, that's magical. You know, thank you. Now, my question is a little bit technical. Now, do they have a backlog in the cases with in the court?
Yes. So that's an interesting and somewhat complicated question, but we have around 500 evictions that the constables held because of the moratorium. There are 4,500 cases that went through the court, but they never brought it to the constable's office, theoretically because the tenant had given their paperwork. And the CDC said that if a tenant gave their paperwork, they're allowed to go to court and get the judgment. They're just not allowed to enforce the eviction. Mm-hmm. So we've got that 500, and then we've got that 4,500. That's an actual paper backlog. Then we've got the non-paper backlog, of which I really don't have any numbers for. We've had some models, you know, upwards of 30,000 families could be evicted. Anecdotally, I can tell you that, for instance, HSL, I don't know how many units they have in town, but they have probably close to about 1,200 units in my precinct, Midtown Tucson. And they have not filed an eviction in over a year now. No, it's probably about a year. Yeah, they haven't filed any non-payment evictions because I suppose their thought was, you know, there's all these moratoria. We're going to work with people internally and we're not going to evict. I used to be at, I used to do approximately, I would say 30 to 40 HSL evictions per month prior to the pandemic. So that's why I'm talking about that non-paper number. I was talking to one of the managers over at HSL a few weeks ago, and she said that if the moratorium does expire and it's, you know, we're back in business April 1st, they're ready to go with evictions. And that's just one property in one precinct. There's other larger apartment complexes that have not filed, same as HSL. So I don't have numbers for that, but I can tell you anecdotally that there's going to be a lot.
Now, I've got to say this. I've talked to a friend of mine that really knows the system somewhat, and it just seems draconian to me. You know, I don't have 1% of your knowledge about this, but to send out a notice, and you got to be out in 5 days. And sometimes, as you well know, they don't even get the notice. Yeah. You know, is there some way the system can be changed, or the procedures, or the process?
We're looking at it. So that's we've been working on different reports. I was part of a county committee late last year where we did come up with, I think it was 12 recommendations, and many of them addressed the court about changes that we want to see reflected in the court process. And especially you brought up noticing. That's been a huge barrier for people, either not receiving notice or not getting it in time.
Right.
And I think there was an article written about that in one of the newspapers recently too. The difficulty is just like how constables are independently elected, the JPs are also independently elected. So telling them to do something is difficult because some of them don't want to do anything different. They think the process is fine.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's some changes we think we can convince them to do. I mean, really, for a lot of these different changes, it has to be done legislatively, which as whenever anybody says that to me, I'm like, ugh, because I know how it's really, really hard to do it. That would be our best bet. But also, I'm going to talk like an activist right now. They're elected. So where that protects them from, like, you know, telling them what to do, they are your elected JP or constable or whomever. Mm-hmm. And they are just as susceptible to political pressure as any other elected. Mm-hmm. So talk to your JP, talk to your constable. And I mean, right now, if anybody's been paying attention in the news, the situations at the Justice Court are a little rough right now anyway. So now might be a good time to apply some constituent pressure.
Thank you very much. Let's turn now to Jackie Romer, who has a question.
what a staggering report. So my question is, are the solutions that you're anticipating or seeing or dealing with or working with, are they focused more on the emergency of the pandemic with evictions? And here I'm referring to families who would never even imagine that they would have 10 minutes to get their all of their beds and belongings and everything out of the garage and the attic and everything else. The trauma involved in that. Are you getting governmental support, local support in terms of this is a pandemic? Are you trying to just deal with this within the normal rules?
well, we're called the Rebel Constables for a reason. And that actually came from a High Country News article in January. So there are the regular rules and we can't exactly break them, but so our attorney with the Constable's office, her name is Nancy Davis. She's with the civil unit and she's been really great about figuring out ways to, I mean, we can't, like I said, we can't break the rules, but because the administrative office of the courts sort of, it must be a record year for administrative orders at the court. So they actually loosened up many of their rules. So that means the timelines are loosened up. That means that all these different things, they just sort of in general kind of made them a little bit looser. So we've been able to use those administrative orders as a way to slow the process down so that we don't have to show up the day after the writ hits my mailbox and go and boot people out. Because basically those timelines were thrown out of the window. The AOC hasn't rescinded those rules yet. So we're still using them. I can't rely on them because at some point they're going to tighten things back down. Wow. But I think what we've learned is, poor Nancy, our lawyer, I feel like I'm asking her for a new legal memo every week. She's been amazing though. But what we did learn is the way that things were done before weren't necessarily done that way because they were done to statute. It just sort of became the way things were done. Mm. So for instance, you would get in the eviction order in your mailbox, you would call the landlord, make the arrangement, go out the very next day, knock on the door, say, hey, you've got a few minutes, grab your stuff, we're locking it up. There's actually nothing in statute that says that we have to do it that way. Statute says that evictions should be done as expeditiously as possible. So I asked our lawyer, well, you know, for non-pandemic times, can I have a legal opinion on what that means? And so it's all arbitrary kind of, because that's basically what statute says. But she gave us a legal memo that said, even in non-pandemic times, it doesn't mean we have to do the eviction immediately, that we can be given some time. And that's something I did learn from Constable Bernal. He was always very good, even before I was a constable, about leveraging some of that vagueness in statute to help a family. So he's really well known for getting an eviction order in. It's a single mom, it's 110 degrees outside. They didn't know the eviction was happening, and telling the landlord, you know, I'm going to be back in 2 days. I'm going to give them some time. And so, I mean, we did end up refining that process so that we go there earlier. But that started with Constable Bernal, and it's going to continue after the pandemic, even though they're going to be removing some of the tools in our toolbox. I think we have learned more about statute and we have different interpretations of it now. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you very much. We have another question from Carol Garr. Carol, go ahead.
Hi. First, I wanted to thank you for all the efforts you're making to try to make the process a little bit kinder for the people. I was not aware, and I'm a real estate broker. I sold for the banks back in the REO crisis, actually twice. an eviction for a foreclosure, they do have that intermediate step. And they apparently did. I didn't know they didn't have that for tenants. If you could do anything to improve that, it would be great. I noticed you said that one of the things that you're trying to offer are extra Section 8 vouchers in case of a crisis situation. However, we all know that it's not just rents that have gone up, it's prices of properties. A lot of people have sold, some of the investors have sold. And so the number of Section 8 properties out there has also decreased. I know that there are some hoops that people have to go through to qualify their property for Section 8. It makes it harder for the landlord. Is there anything that anyone is working on to try to make more Section 8 properties available out there for these people?
That is obviously that's a very complicated question. When I first came on board, I think a few months later, there was an article in the Daily Star about how many unused Section 8 vouchers that the city was kind of hanging on to. There was also a larger inventory of Section 8 properties 5 years ago than there is now. In fact, we work with the Pima County a housing center a lot, and they have this little sheet that they hand out to people with affordable properties. And I remember the one girl over there, she was telling me, she's like, I've watched this diminish to like one page thing in the last few years. Some of that is market pressure. Some of it, unfortunately, was because of issues with the city. The Section 8 program was having some hard times. And some of the feedback I got from property managers was that, as you mentioned, there are some hoops you have to jump through. One of them is the inspection. So each unit has to be inspected prior to occupancy of someone with the Section 8 voucher. The properties would, they would get the application in, they would fill all the paperwork, and then they would sometimes be waiting on these inspections for up to 6 months. I heard somebody complain that it took 8 months to get the inspection. The problem is they're already renting at below market rate for that reimbursement on the Section 8 voucher. But when you have to hold that property and keep it vacant for 6 to 8 months, that's, for them, that's not a good business decision. So there were some other concerns with the Section 8 program. It was reimbursement wasn't happening. Sometimes they weren't getting their checks in time. That's a few years ago. There's a new housing director. She's been deeply committed to fixing those problems. She's gone around. She's spoken with property managers. So a lot of those problems are being fixed. There's some like kind of innovative out of the box thinking, like she's working with nonprofits to have them trained up to be able to do the inspections so that you're not only relying on city staff to do it. They hired Terry with OPCS to work in the city housing department. So he had all of that background knowledge. I mean, Terry and I used to sit there and we used to complain about the process, and now he's working for them. So, but they are actually doing a really great job. They were very aware of those issues. They are addressing them. From where I stand, complaints from the property managers have gone down. But as far as increasing the inventory available to Section 8, I think what they've been doing over there is they've been trying to have these one-on-one conversations with the property managers who used to be with Section 8 and then pulled out a few years ago. I know they've been able to add some. I don't think they've lost any large ones in the last year since the new people have been on there. So that's good. And I just see it's at this point, I feel like the market pressure stuff aside, because there's not much we can do about that in the short run, but it's those conversations. I've personally been able to have property managers who told me, nope, I'm out of Section 8. And just because of the relationships I've built with them, just say, hey, I've got this person, come on, please. And just having that conversation and talking to them about the changes being made with the city, we've opened up more inventory. So when I say we, you know, I'm not in charge of that, but because I'm sort of tangentially involved, I would say that given another year or two, they're going to be able to build up that trust. And I hope that answers your question. When I was 18, I'm from a relatively middle-class family. My mom was a teacher. My dad was an engineer. And at 18 years old, I became pregnant, and my parents, I don't think they were emotionally able to deal with that. So they drove me to a dirt road, in the middle of nowhere, New York, and dropped me off at the side of the road. So I lived in a tent. I bathed in a stream. I was about 4 or 5 months pregnant. Never had worked a day in my life because, I was 18 and, I've been there. I know how hard it is, and I know how hard it is to overcome. I know the barrier, and I'm incredibly grateful. And I recognize my privilege as a white woman in a state, New York, that had a lot of resources to help me out. So when I'm working with these people, I see myself in every face, every child, every scared mother. And often these people have barriers that I didn't have. The mentally ill, talk about barriers. Nahadeen and I just worked with a case where we worked with for 5 weeks to try to find her housing. And it was difficult. People of color, people with cognitive issues, the elderly, anybody on a fixed income. I mean, there's barriers for days. So is there any silver bullet? There isn't. But I do this job because it is deeply personal for me. And thank you for your thanks. I never thought I would be doing this, but I'm happy I am.
Let's turn to Jeremy Lasher. Jeremy, go ahead with your question.
Hi, Kristen. Sorry. Thank you so much for the work you're doing. And you guys have done an amazing job here in Pima County. I had a question if you've had any luck talking with other constables or even the justices around the state on trying to take some of the practices you put in place and expand them. Arizona as a whole is looking at about 4% eviction rate over the last 3 years. But in Maricopa County, especially in Western Maricopa County, some of those communities have a 1 in 5 household eviction rate. So 20% of people being thrown out of their homes. I think some of the processes you put in place here in Pima could be really helpful throughout the state. And I wanted to see if you had any luck reaching out either through the legislature and our Pima County legislators, or through the constables and the justices of the pieces around the state to try and build on those impacts you've made.
Thank you for that question. It is a complicated political question. So the short answer is yes and yes. The long answer is we have actually gotten a lot of pushback for what we do. Bennett was always, when he was kind of on his own in the office, they sort of just let him do whatever, but they would make sort of snide comments about what he was working on. When we started to kind of formalize what we were doing, we did have constables within our office who told us they didn't want us doing it, that they were looking at ways to actually prevent us from doing it. And so that was difficult. With Maricopa County, I know that Constable Bernal has even recently talked about what we were doing, and there was pushback among many of the Maricopa County constables. But there is a contingent of the Democratic constables up in Maricopa. Many of them are actually very involved in the state party. So Karen Lathan, Mahogany Kennedy, Darlene Martinez, these are three Maricopa County constables who share our values. And we are actually working with them to give them information, to give them the legal memos that I get from our attorney, to give them to them so that they can have some sort of framework to start doing the same thing. The difficulty with them is that there's a lot more constables up there, and there, a lot of them are more Republican, and not like that should matter, because caring about people's not partisan, but it, for whatever reason, it seems to matter. And they have a very heavy, more top-down structure for whatever reason. So they've actually specifically been told by their leadership that they're not allowed to do certain things. And that's why I've been working with them to try to get their own legal memos. So they could basically say, hey, you know, all right, you can say whatever you want, but I'm independently elected, and the lawyer says this is fine. So we are actually working on that, but not without some challenges. And then with the legislators, I've been working with Senator Engel now for the last 2 years. Last session, when she was still at the House, she did drop a bill. She had discussed actually adding the step that we have in there that most other states have, adding it in into statute. But she thought that probably politically right now it wouldn't work. So her bill added permissive language, because we've been told by some constables that they don't want this to happen, or that we would get sued, or whatever it was. She wanted to make it something that was in statute where we were permitted to do it. So that bill didn't really go anywhere last session. She dropped that bill again this session now in the Senate. And then she also dropped a bunch of other eviction related bills. So I don't want to get into them all, but she's been amazing. And we've had actually really great support with the legislature. I've worked with Dr. Freeze on a few other things. I've had conversations with almost all of them, with Representative Steele, Representative Powers Hanley, Domingo. We've had conversations for the last few years. They've all been really great, but we, you know, without having a better balance up in Phoenix, it's a little bit difficult.
Thank you.
Tony Zinman is a member of our board, and he's a public defender, and he's got a question. Go ahead, Tony.
Kristen, thanks again for all the incredible work you're doing. Wanted to ask about something. A friend of mine that knows about these things that I don't told me that current situation as far as housing is going to change quite a bit in about a year. It's going to be a serious crash, because a lot of people that have had the protection from paying their monthly mortgages and their rent, when the moratoriums expire, they're going to have, you know, $10,000 in backed up rent that they can't pay. So there might be a crash. What have you heard about that in the future?
So the only thing I've heard is again from my economist friend at the U of A. His models are pretty grim. And I think it sort of follows with what you're saying, that the recession is going to stretch and it could potentially deepen. We are seeing, his model suggests that we are going to see foreclosures on homes. And then of course, more evictions and rentals. I think that's a challenge. You know, when I was laying out this talk, I wanted to talk about, here's the problem, here's what we're doing in the short term, and here's what we need to do in the long term. And we really, really need to address some of these things coming up. And we need to have plan B, C, and D. And I think the problem is when we're looking at these models, it's not just Tucson, it's not just Pima County, it's not even just Arizona. We're looking at potentially a countrywide issue. different than the last recession because it's coming from a different place. But hopefully it doesn't end up, I mean, they'll probably end up calling it the, you know, it's equalized. The market is equalizing and make it sound nicer. But when we were talking about equalizing, and we're talking about, families homeless, so I hope that answers your question. It's pretty grim. I can try to, I think Keith's latest report and model is public. I'll see if I can share it with Larry and maybe he can get that out to people.
All right. We have a lot of questions lined up. A lot of people want to ask you, but unfortunately we've run out of time. So, we are a political organization, Kristen, and what can we do to elect more constables like you? How can we get a hold of you, and how can we support you in your mission?
I think the first step is figure out what justice precinct you live in. So there are 10 of them in Pima County. You can go to, and it's probably not some, it's not, it is a separate, different district. It's not lined up with anything. It is the justice precinct. So you can go to your recorder's office. There's that little sidebar there and click on the link. I forget what it's called exactly, but it's the one where you can figure out what all your districts and wards and different things are and look and see what that is. And then you can go to the Pima County Constable's website, match that up with who your constable is. And if it's me, hi, and thank you. And just see who it is. See if they have social media. I have a constable social media, a few others do, most don't. So you could always call our office at 724-5442 to try and get in contact with your constable. We are your representative. We are your in the field connection to the justice court. So call us up, get to know us, find out about what our philosophy is on how we deal with these things. Consider running for constable. In some ways it's a very heartbreaking and tough job. But the thing is if you like a mission, then this is definitely a mission. And if you want to help people, think about every person you elect on your ballot, all the way from constable, all the way up to president. Who else is the person you vote for who is physically in the community and making contact with people every single day in their official capacity, not just shaking hands, but in their official capacity? That's your constable. So get to know them and consider running for constable. If you have any questions, please reach out to me. My contact information, my work number is 850-3973. My work email is just my name, kristen.randall@pima.gov. And if you have any other questions about constables, you know, reach out and ask me. I'd love to talk to you about it. You know, talk to Bennett or just call up your own constable and learn more.
Well, Kristen, thank you so much. And you know, I think I speak for everybody at today's Democrats of Greater Tucson meeting that, you know, you really are doing important work. It's great to know that there are officials out there like you who have a heart. And we wish you all the best and much success in your mission. And with that, I'm going to have to wrap up today's meeting. We've run out of time. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming. Please return next week when we'll have another meeting. Thanks very much, everybody.